Hello friends, okay, I'm Jayanthi, she's already told, and I'm working for Polaris software and consulting services at Gurgaon, and I have more than 15 years of experience being connected with the IT, and I'm CSM, EMP, PMI, ACP, ITIL, and SAFE certified. And I should first thank Saket and Piali who gave me this opportunity. They don't even know that I speak well or not. I just published a blog in Disk is Agile, and she within a week's time she said we are conducting a workshop. Why don't you speak? So you know I really admire her confidence. She has not even spoken to me or she has not even seen me. Just with the small blog I published, she had the confidence and invited me. I'm really grateful. And to be frank, I haven't spoken much like this in any workshops, you know. I'm expecting, good response, and you know, I feel really thrilled about, speaking in this session here. Okay. And this is on dependency management in Agile. So, in many of our projects, we'll be seeing a lot of dependencies, whether it is across teams. Or across some functional units or database or whatever, and we know if we do not manage that properly, what will happen? Okay, so I had given some solution, not exactly solution, various ways to handle the dependency. Okay, so this is about myself, which I've already spoken, and we all know what dependencies are. Dependencies are basically relationship between functional units, okay? And in our regular project management, we might have seen start to start, start to end, all that. So if you don't handle, especially in Agile, if you don't handle what will happen, the Agile will ultimately, you will end up making it a scrum fall or a waterfall finally, if you don't handle them on time and don't detect and then handle it after. So this is what I've been highlighting here. If you don't handle, it will become a dependency hell. So what the dependency hell is, becoming a scrum fall or a waterfall. Okay? Now, how is first planning done in scrum? So, unlike a traditional WBS, in scrum, we do planning through the product backlog is what we are aware of. And we all write user stories, the product owner writes user stories into the product backlog. Okay? Now, in the product backlog, we know we talk about the user stories, and this we are all aware of, how should a good user story be. We know that it should be independent, negotiable, valuable, estimable, small and estimable, invest principle we talk about, okay? So, but in reality, when you actually go to a product backlog, are they really independent? The answer is no. Though we put down a functional breakdown like this, showing, different features and different stories. Okay, are they really independent stories? The answer is no. So, how do we handle them? Okay, so the textbook of Scrum doesn't really talk, is silent on dependencies. Okay, so when you go into reality, now how will you handle that? So, how independent are these user stories? Okay, so you must be having either data dependency or inter-team dependency. So different types of dependencies will be there. Okay. So and we know how we function in Agile. We don't say in one particular sprint you'll have to work on three or four user stories. How do we do it in waterfall? We start coding everything. We start testing everything, and then we try to build everything, and you get the working software a day or two before actually releasing it for SIT. But in Agile, it shouldn't be done that way, right? So you have to. Every user story has to be code, test, and then build, right? And on top of it, you will be building another user story. So net, you will always be having a working software in a Scrum kind of methodology that you follow. Okay? So when you have these dependencies, again, the problem increases. So you will not be able to build that user story because we have dependency on the other. Now, what are the different types of dependencies? Okay, one is inter-story. So you have dependencies between stories. Another thing is, next one is inter-team. You have dependencies between teams. Okay, a story, one story will have some data dependency on a story done by another team, especially when you go in for bigger frameworks, I mean, even when you have multiple teams working. The other one is inter-product or release. So you, a team may be working on one particular product, and that may be still depending on some other product. And other one is external dependencies. You still have vendors, third parties, or customer dependencies, or even people dependencies. So, you know, how are they going to be handled? Okay. Yeah. So first thing which I proposed was, in Scrum itself, we have the concept called minimal marketable feature, and you have something called MVP. So MVP is minimum viable product. Okay. So, another concept we have is something called user story mapping, which we'll be learning it in our PMI-ACP course, where we do story mapping. So story mapping is the base for having an MMF and then a chain of MVPs. So unlike waterfall, where we start building the small components or features to develop the main one, in Agile, we try to take the MVP route. That is, we find which is the most wanted feature by the customer, and then we work backwards. What is the minimum route it takes to go and reach there? Okay. So this way you can group out your dependent stories to form the minimal marketable feature, and you can code, test, and build based on your MMF to build the MVP here. So this is one approach which I have suggested. The second one is the product backlog. When you do prioritization, it's going to the same thing. So you do a Moscow prioritization. You can do one Moscow prioritization at a feature level, okay? And in the feature, you will have multiple stories for which you can again do a Moscow prioritization to identify which are again the most key features that are required for the feature, okay? And you can group, and in your product backlog, you can also have a flag called dependency, where you can flag and say user story number one is dependent on another user story. So this flagging, you can do it in tools also. If directly there is a field, use it. Otherwise, if you have some other placeholder, you can try to map dependencies in the product backlog itself. So this is what is my second suggestion.
Right. Can you explain about the Moscow prioritization? What do you exactly think better?
Yeah, Moscow prioritization is one of the product backlog prioritization technique, where M stands for must have. Okay, then it is should have, could have, and won't have. Okay, so you can take one feature. Okay, I'm not talking about user stories. Take one feature. You have set of features in the product backlog. So you prioritize which are must have. So from that must have feature, you have set of user stories. So you can again do a Moscow at a feature level, and then you know which are the must have. For example, I'll take an example of, say, you are building an Amazon kind of application. What is my main screen that I require? Which is the main feature I require? Selecting a product and then buying it. Okay, so that is the main thing I require. So what it takes me to go there? Okay, I would require something like a product catalog and a user authentication, set of users, and payment, the cost of each product. So if I have these, that is enough for me to develop the main thing. So there could be other features like forgot password, number of views, reviews. I mean, they all need not be developed in the beginning itself to go to the main thing. Say captcha will be another feature. So they all will be developed, but can be done at a later stage. So this way you can group the dependencies is what I'm trying to say. Next is structuring of the team. Okay, when you structure the team, normally it's always confusing whether to have component-based teams or feature-based teams or competency-based teams. Okay, so component teams. You know, I've seen in projects where you may be having, say, Java component and .NET components also. So the immediate tendency is to have a Java component team separate, and then .NET component teams separate. Okay, there could be various reasons for that. You know, it's probably a mindset, and then you know they feel Java teams, with that competency can collaborate with each other well. There could be various reasons, but when it comes to developing a feature, you know, the dependencies more. Okay, so another way of organizing team is the feature teams. So based on features, you can still align your teams. Okay, and in each feature team, you can have a cross-functional cross-functional team where multiple technology team members are involved. So in a way, I would say feature team would be better because that will reduce the dependency to some extent. Yeah.
What is the difference between a scrum team and a feature team here?
Scrum team only. I'm talking about. Yes, see, so, assume we have multiple scrum teams. Okay, I have four or five scrum teams. My project size is bigger, and I have four or five scrum teams. So how do you structure your teams having dependencies in mind? So normal tendencies, people try to go for component-based teams or competency-based teams. Okay, another thing is each scrum team will be working on some set of features.
That is equalizing the feature team, the scrum team, because
correct.
Scrum team is also a team which has all the cross-functional team into it and they work.
Correct.
So we can call that team also the feature team.
Correct.
They work on a, you categorize that team on a separate feature. For example, same example Amazon, this team will work on say login page, this team will work on, is it that?
Very true. Very true. May not be one, you can group like that. So dependency hell will be reduced.
Yeah.
But you know, there are so many projects which I have seen who are still traditional and they have, you know, especially bigger systems where you have, components built out of Java, .NET, Pega, Mule and so many other technologies. Even they have testing competency. So the tendency is, you know, have one team for Java, then have one team for .NET and let them build the components and let us try to stitch those components. So that time the dependency help increases and again you will end up doing a waterfall. Correct. Very true.
You say that as a user, I should be able to do this. I should be able to do
correct.
Then only a Java component may not be cheap.
Very true. So you land up doing waterfall. You know, let's build half of it, and then you know when you try to stitch again, it becomes a waterfall.
So your recommendation is that you should always.
But it's better, okay? And sometimes, you know, you cannot avoid the components. There may be, you know, traditional projects where, you know, they are used to having separate component teams. Then what you can do is, you can have, another suggestion is, you can have a feature team, okay? In that feature team, have a Java person and have a .NET person. And if there is a, there are other, competents who are experts in that component, you can have one person shared across teams. Anyway, he should be part of that feature team. You can have the component experts in that feature team. Okay, maybe he shared across multiple teams. That is also fine. So that also has worked in some of the projects which I have seen. So you can align your teams also in such a way the dependency is getting reduced.
But ma'am, in Agile we don't have a component team. If we are creating a team, we have a person from different backgrounds, then we create a scrum team or feature team.
Agree, fully agree. That's what I'm saying. There are cases where people are so used to, you know, the organization and the portfolio is structured in such a way that you have teams aligned that way. Even I have seen in a few of our customers, in the US, they have even told, you know, we don't have QA as part of the scrum team. Mm-hmm. Sorry, we have our own business reasons for that. Our QA is separate, QA will do separate testing and they will not be part of the scrum team. So you tell us how you solve our problem. Okay, QA will not be there. We'll have only developers and we'll have the business analysts, but QA is separate, they'll test multiple, they'll be doing multiple application testing. So you know how will you how will you help us? So there is a problem. Agree. So you have to see. Yeah. In that case, what we have done is there is a gap definitely, and they are very strong in not doing it. So you one gap is first this you can ask them to participate in your ceremonies at least once in a week or some agreed frequency. See why? What is the problem if they are separate? What is the problem we see? Because one is a communication problem, right? Once you give it for QA, you have to again start explaining them everything, or you have to give them some documents and everything. The communication gap will be lost. Will be wasting time on transition, right? So to avoid that, you have to ask them to be part of your scrum ceremonies at least once in a week, or you know, at some agreed frequency. We'll have to tell them first. We'll have to tell them the risk, and we'll have to ask them to participate. Okay, this is one. And any updates you have, and especially sprint reviews, invite them also. Let them also be there, and you know, so that they are aware of what is happening, and so that you spend less time when you do it for QA.
I'm not able to understand the situation. You're saying that the customer don't have any QA team.
No, they have a QA team, but it is horizontal. It is horizontal and not will be part of the Scrum team. They're saying the Scrum team will be there and the QA will be horizontal.
That becomes waterfall kind of.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. How do you avoid that in such situation? Ask them to participate in your Scrum ceremonies. And second thing is try to bridge the tools. You may be using Jira, they may be using QC. Try to use some plugin to bridge both the tools. So you have to see how to, you know, first we should analyze what is the problem if they are separate. What is the problem? We'll be spending time on transition, communication gap, and make them understand, you know, what is the latest information or what is the latest update on the application. So how to bridge the gap is what you'll have to do.
Possible, correct. So I had such a scenario where we had little team and you know, very functional team there. So what we used to do, like you suggested, we used to keep the QA inside the Scrum team. They were not doing any stuff within what the other Scrum developers were doing there. But they will still be, you know, part of the planning focus sessions and all of that, and they will start the story elaboration about how these things are happening during sprint review.
And the next part is tools. Try to see how to bridge both the tools.
The first part is how to bring the different kind of people involved.
True.
That's a human kind of thing. But I'm a .NET guy, he's Java guy, he's a database guy.
True.
That's a challenge. Scrum will start once they have, you have one team. That's what I'm struggling with.
And the next is our regular Scrum of Scrum meetings where you discuss.
What the best practice says, should we include the QC in the Scrum team or should we keep?
You should include.
Something should have everybody in the team. In the team.
Correct. You should have them in the team. Because unlike in waterfall, where we ramp up initially, have more business analysts, and then you bring in developers, and then you know only when testing phase starts, you bring the testing team. That will not work in Agile because though people, you know, the PMOs may talk about budget and all those things, but people don't realize you'll be spending and wasting a lot of time explaining them, and you know the rework effort is more. So rather include them in the beginning so that they are on the curve right from the beginning. Let them start building the EE2E. If they are not doing automation testing, they are still in the manual world. Let them start building the EE2E from the beginning when the user stories are tested and all those things. My next thing is Scrum of Scrum meetings, which I suggest here.
So I have one that you said you wanted to So you can include that team if they are active. Right. As you said, the customer is not, you know, ready to blame you, you know, kind of include that team within your team.
Correct.
So let's say the developer team is on location and the QA team is another location. And in that case, customer said, okay, we don't want any QA team to be included in the developer team. And if you go to that QA team and they said, okay, we are not permitted for the client and deployment itself, then they might not design you for the engineering.
See, first we'll have to highlight the risk to the customer. We'll tell them, see, you're wanting this to be done, executed in Agile. This is the expectation. Okay. For business reasons or any reason, if they are not able to, we'll have to tell them at least this is the bare minimum thing that's expected.
So
let them
participate. You need to share the concept of Agile.
Correct.
So you need to share the idea that put their nice and upfront tell the customer.
Correct.
Inviting the everybody, Yes. We should tell that we are not following Scrum.
Correct. Yeah.
So we need to kind of go to the customer.
Yeah, yeah. That's very true. And this Scrum of Scrum meetings, this is another thing which we all know. So where dependencies are explicitly tracked. Okay. And the dependencies, as I told, need not just be inter-team. Could be vendors or some other third party also. So we need to identify them upfront. So when you do a sprint planning, you should be aware of the dependencies and accordingly plan your sprints. You know, whether the vendor is ready with their component or their part, only then you need to decide whether that has to go into the sprint. Otherwise, you will not be meeting the DOD and because of the dependency, you will not be able to achieve that story on time. It is normally done once in a week, depending on the complexity of the project. Once in a week is enough. Okay, and if there is a time zone difference also, then probably you can have it twice a week. So in our projects, we first had it twice a week, and then slowly we switched over to once in a week. Yeah? Yeah. Oh, this is actually this is Scrum of Scrum meeting. Ma'am, that is when you have multiple Scrum teams.
We are not able to hear. Actually, if you can repeat that question, that's very helpful.
No,
she is asking if you can repeat that.
Okay. What were the questions?
We are not able to hear.
Okay.
Just like anyway, you can repeat the question because you have a mic, so everybody.
Oh, okay. She her question is her question is like who conducts the Scrum of Scrum meetings. And how is it done? And she wants to know. See, Scrum, when you have multiple Scrum teams, okay, a Scrum, we know that a Scrum team cannot be more than, say, 9 members, okay? So, but the project with the modules and the features and the complexity demands you to have multiple Scrum teams. Then each Scrum team will have their own Scrum ceremonies, and you will have to have one Scrum of Scrum master who will conduct the meeting to discuss dependencies. Between the Scrum teams. You got this?
He can be a project owner also. The project owner can be part of the Scrum of Scrum.
Scrum of Scrum Master is a separate role, like a Scrum Master.
Okay. He can be a Scrum Master from the team.
He'll be doing more like a program manager role. I think that's the better term which I. Anybody has any questions on this Scrum of Scrum? Will it be experienced?
So I had a client where there's a person from master in the place, and we had 3-4 vendors, and one vendor itself is a Scrum team.
Okay.
So he used to conduct a meeting in different time zones, basically, and it's a fortnightly meeting where my company was one of the vendors, there was another company was one of the vendors, and all the Scrum masters were there. And he used to conduct that meeting, and dependency between those vendors, he used to resolve those.
So the Scrum Master could resolve the dependencies and the
Scrum Master?
There will be 5 Scrum Masters sitting in a room and discussing the...
Chief Scrum Master.
Yeah, you call it Chief Scrum Master or Scrum of Scrum Master. In the traditional language, it's nothing. It's more like a program manager role. Only the work is not assigned. Rather, you track dependencies program manager's role is additionally tracking change requests and all those things. But this is mainly to track dependencies and... Yeah.
So, is this an example of advanced Agile?
No, it is first step of scaling up the Agile. Agile is meant for co-located maximum of 9 member team. Okay. So, today we are in a situation where we have to scale up. So, first level of scaling will be Scrum of Scrum. Having multiple Scrum teams.
So, this can go at n number of levels?
Yes,
you
yes.
Can have Scrum
yeah,
Scrum
we have various scaling frameworks which maybe Saket's Jim will be also talking.
On that,
we have Sage, we have Less, CAD,
we have a course called
Spotify. So many scaling frameworks are there.
market use a program called Scale Agile.
Okay.
The
next is visualizing your dependencies. So you can use your Scrum or Kanban boards where you are able to visualize dependencies. Okay. So either take a thread and then join these stories to show that there is some dependency, or you can put a small tag here showing that it's an external dependency. Here with some other story. So visualize it is what one more suggestion which I have given. Okay. The next is have a central dependency team. Okay, especially for large enterprise programs. I've seen where it's more than 100, 150 members. You'll have so many teams. So in that situation, it's better you have one dedicated dependency team who will only keep doing the job of tracking dependencies from all the teams and try to take them to closure. Okay, this is one more suggestion which I am giving. The next is, I'm done with this kind of dependencies.
The last point which you said, we are suggestion to have one team, maybe a team of two or three persons. So
correct.
We'll be interacting with maybe different scrum masters.
Correct.
To understand and to find out what dependencies
are
coming up in the next sprint so that they can be resolved.
Very
but,
true.
But that answer we are going to get in scrum of scrum.
Correct. Scrum of scrum.
I mean, that has to be
that also can be a cross-functional, you know, in case you are yours is a multiple competency enterprise, then you can have one Java architect or expert as part of the dependency team who will be able to close out on the dependencies related to that. You can have an Oracle guy, or you can have a process person, or you can have a testing person. They'll be testing dependencies. I mean, it's just suggestion which I've seen in my
practice. But I want to understand if you are implementing somewhere.
Yeah.
So how do they, these three people, four people work? Do they have their own scrum or something like?
So they will work closely with this scrum team, scrum masters. Correct. This is taken from that only.
I mean, a lot of dependencies should and will come in the scrum.
Horizontal. So
for example, there are need of a creative person in your project.
Yeah.
And there's just horizontal. I mean, there's one department of creative people, creative studio in your organization. And you want some of the one or two person in your project. So if you have your scrum team and there's another project scrum team, and so you can have that person for some time and you can resolve those interdependencies between two of the scrum masters and the person.
So in this scenario, are we talking like we should have scrum masters specific to each team, or one scrum master can be a member of different team? If he is a member of a different team and he is a scrum master of a different team, then how he will manage the scrum of scrum?
You mean to say a scrum master being shared across teams?
Yes.
See, I depends on the complexity. If the scrum master and the maturity of the team is matured enough to self-organize and do things by them, that's what the textbook scrum says, but in reality it may not be. Some kind of hand-holding may be required. So if your team is matured enough and are able to remove the blocks, everything by themselves, then a scrum master can definitely be shared across teams. There's nothing wrong.
Yeah, I have another example for this. So for example, I have a 30-member team, right? So I don't want to, my manager doesn't want that there would be three or four scrum masters within that project. So I can build, 9 or 8 members team, depending on the features components she do. And those teams, those scrum teams will be managed only by me. So I will be scrum master for all these 3 or 4 teams and coordinating with different product owners of these 4 teams.
As per you, your team is working on different products.
Yes.
Still, capacity of Scrum Master, how he handles
two people. He can even remove and he has, the team members will not be reporting to him also.
Yes.
You can put a team lead inside that Scrum team and then you'll manage the,
Logically speaking, one scrum master is enough for a one scrum.
I mean, it's better to assign somebody from
the
team.
This is theoretically correct, but practically, sometimes
it doesn't work. I have faced the challenge. I was scrum master for two different teams. I got mad.
I wrote a blog.
If they report to you, what it says is doing this appraisal and then you know
should be out of the scrum master.
Is out of the scrum framework.
Yes.
That way separate person.
That is the role of mine. I don't do any appraisal. Okay.
Because
if the team reports, I only get the things and do it. Then only
because reporting relationship is something different. If the boss says, fine, I'm your buddy, fine, let's eat, that's okay. But it may not be all the time like that, right? And you may not be expressing your problems very freely if he's your reporting manager, right? It's very rare that you know someone does
that. But in reality, it is very telling, you know, hard to find one dedicated scrum master for one team. Practically, you're not there.
Yeah, yeah, I understand.
Yeah, cost cutting is there, not the
company. You'll cut cost there and you'll get cost over some years later.
And even not realize teams are playing the role of scrum master, that's why there's a fact that I'm not technical.
So many funny things happen here because I in Gurgaon also I've seen, I don't want to mention the customer name, you know, their IT is so keen on going on Agile, but not the business. So they, you know, ask for roles like Scrum Master come BA. That means they don't have to do their job. I've seen that. Then we had to go back and then we can't
do it.
So such crazy things happen.
This is very common. This is very common. Scrum Master usually plays a BA role.
Yes.
No role actually.
Yeah, we get nobody wants to buy a scrum master. So
true. That is true.
Exactly.
So that's why, you know, I mean, I don't have to say most of us are in the agile world. It's a very tricky thing, right? Because there are, you should categorize customers like this who know agile, okay, and have actually implemented agile and have the agile mindset. So the way you deal with them is different. And there are customers who actually don't know agile at all, but have the buy-in. They still want to follow agile. So you have to train them, coach them, and then create that mindset. That is a different equation.
Yes.
There are some cases who think they know Agile, but really they don't know. That is the case you have to handle.
That is a majority of problem.
If
I do some daily stand-up meeting and do some iterative delivery, I'm Agile, people think.
Ma'am, in that case, if we are a service provider, then we should teach them or let them know the benefit of Agile.
Yeah. We should be doing that. Yeah.
It's our responsibility.
Right? And Agile, and you know, many think Agile means it's only Scrum.
Yes.
Okay.
Only,
whether it is
only
summer
setup.
Only setup.
They think Scrum is Agile is Scrum.
Yes. And one more word they say, quick wins. You're doing Agile, you know? When will be delivery?
Okay. And many get confused between iterative waterfall or MTLC and Agile. And I've seen so many proposals, they ask for so many documents, they say we require sign off from our program manager and everything, and somewhere they will mention the word Agile or Scrum in the RFP.
Yeah, so we do have a session which talks about the hybrid thing.
Yeah,
we will discuss them there.
Fine.
Let's close
the
dependency
close this,
one first.
Yeah, and the other thing is, this is he's my, K.V. Sharma is my, you know, Agile and DevOps practice head. Actually, he also motivated me, you know, and gave a lot of ideas in writing this blog, okay? So, you know, I just wanted to acknowledge that. And second thing is, I'm thankful to Saket and Piali.
Mm-hmm.
I told him in the beginning. Knowing what my skills are, they invited and asked me to speak. That is really great and I feel so thrilled about it. And I should thank her again and again. I don't mind repeating it.
It was our pleasure to have you.
Fine. Yeah? And? Final conclusion is, we can't avoid dependencies anyway, they're part of the function. How we try to handle them upfront before than creating a waterfall or a scrum. Yeah.